Protocol Number 7. 1. Intensification of armaments, the increase of police forces, are all essential for the completion of the aforementioned plans.
Bring the action.
This was a protest near the White House on June 1st.
It has been an entirely peaceful protest.
It was met by forces with helmets, riot shields, rifles, and tear gas. The authorities here were a mix of police and military. There were Secret Service, Park Police, the National Guard, prison special operations, and local police from a nearby county. But can you tell which ones are the police? If it's hard to tell, it's these guys, by the way. It's because America's police have been looking more and more like troops.
Get in the hole!
So why do American police officers look like soldiers?
Why are you and Ryan here?
And where did they get all these weapons? In the 1980s, police in America looked more like this. The US's crime rate had been doing this, and President Reagan called for the military to work more directly with the police for the war on drugs.
Drugs are menacing our society. We must move to strengthen law enforcement activities.
Congress agreed, and over the next few years passed a series of bills to give police access to military bases and equipment, for the National Guard to assist police with drug operations, for the military and police to train together, and eventually to have the military loan police departments their excess leftover equipment for free. This would become known as the 1033 program. Police departments got assault rifles like M16s, armored trucks, and even grenade launchers. And before long, it started to have an effect on how police. We can see that in the number of times SWAT teams were used. Departments that had deployed them about once a month in the 80s were using them more than 80 times a year by 1995. Almost all of these deployments were for drug-related search warrants, usually forced entry searches called no-knock warrants. The police were becoming militarized, and people noticed. This 1997 article said it made police look like an occupying army. In February of 1997, two men robbed a bank in North Hollywood, Los Angeles. They had automatic rifles and body armor. The police didn't.
They've got automatic weapons. There's nothing we have that can stop them.
By the time it ended, a dozen police officers were injured. In the aftermath of the shootout, California police demanded they be equipped with assault rifles, like the AR-15. But so did police in places from Florida to Connecticut. And that same year, the 1033 program was expanded, dropping the requirement that police departments use the equipment for drug-related enforcement. Now any law enforcement, even university police, could access leftover military weapons for any reason. A retired police chief in Connecticut told the New York Times, "I was offered tanks, bazookas, anything I wanted." Because complete records on these loans weren't kept until 2015, we don't know exactly how much equipment was given out in those early years. But we do have data on how much of it police departments still have from each year it was given out. And you can see a steady growth in the program for most of the 90s and 2000s. And then something happens around here.
The rest of our troops in Iraq will come home by the end of the year.
In 2011, the U.S. military formally withdrew its troops from Iraq. That meant the military had a lot of equipment and one less war to use it on. So it became available to the police. This is a mine-resistant ambush protected vehicle, or MRAP. It's among the most controversial equipment given out under the 1033 program. And we know from the data that police departments still have several hundred of them that they got in 2013 and 2014, but none from 2015. That's because in August of 2014, the 1033 program became national news.
We just said, hands up, don't shoot! And they just start shooting!
A police officer in Ferguson, Missouri, had shot and killed an unarmed black teenager, Michael Brown. Afterwards, the community's protests were met by heavily militarized police, who pointed sniper rifles at them as they marched.
Tear gas and armored tanks became a familiar sight in Ferguson, Missouri.
The police departments around the country have been getting a lot of this type of equipment.
President Obama responded with an executive order curbing the 1033 program.
We've seen how militarized gear can sometimes give people a feeling like There's an occupying force as opposed to a force that's part of the community that's protecting them and serving them.
2 years later, President Trump's administration reversed it.
We will not put superficial concerns above public safety.
But by that point, the 1033 program had become a lot less important anyway. This chart shows that by 2016, most MRAPs loaned out by the military went to smaller police departments. That means when larger cities today have MRAPs and other military gear, it's often because they've bought it themselves. And that's because police having military gear and weapons no longer depends on any one government program. There are definitely times when it's been more clearly beneficial for the police to have this equipment. For example, during the Pulse nightclub shooting in 2016, Orlando police used an armored military vehicle to stop the shooter. But those moments tend to be the exception. Today, this equipment is still mostly used by SWAT teams for executing drug-related search warrants. And more than half of those are still no-knock warrants, the kind that Louisville police were executing when they killed Breonna Taylor. And in the case of the Ferguson protests, the Department of Justice found that the heavily militarized presence served to escalate rather than de-escalate the overall situation. The military and the police are supposed to serve different purposes. A military protects an us from a them. A police officer is supposed to be a part of the us. But when police think of themselves as soldiers, that can change.
What is the police officer going to do with an assault rifle when he's facing a protest? You know, seriously, when you give someone a hammer, why are you surprised that everything looks like a nail to them?
This is Ryan Dawson of ANC Report. Here is some more footage from the anti-APAC conference held April 10th in Washington, D.C. I had the privilege of giving media coverage for this event. This is a question for Dr. Rothschild about American police being trained by Israelis.
Okay, so I'm being asked, what is the New York Police Department doing in Israel? And there are no blacks there to kill except the Ethiopian Jews. So first of all, that's not quite correct. There are Sudanese and Eritrean asylum seekers who are black who are subjected to horrific amount of racism, so there are blacks to kill. But that's not the answer. So the thing that you need to understand is that what sort of the Israeli PR is that one of their biggest products is security, and that they really know how to do crowd control. I mean, they've been occupying a whole ton of people for decades now, and so they have the expertise to do crowd control and to fight terrorism. And when you sort of investigate this a little bit, not only do they have the most advanced weaponry, mostly from us, but they have developed a huge system of collaborators and sort of a malicious kind of security system to keep a population under control. So what our American cities want to do is to learn how to control us. They want to learn how to control protests and crowds. They want to learn how to fight, quote, terrorism, as it is getting more and more broadly defined. And Israel is supposed to have the best product. So that's what our policemen are doing in Israel. The other thing that is very, very worrisome, I think, is, for instance, if you look at the wall between the U.S. and Mexico, that is partly built by an Israeli company because they're also really good at building walls to keep people out or in or whatever they're doing. So, and the thing that gets even more messy about this whole thing is that our U.S. military now has all this excess equipment now that we're not actively killing a whole bunch of people, we're just kind of doing it more slowly. So the military is now giving our police departments tanks and, you know, things you might need to do if you're doing traffic in Idaho or something. So we have a police that are weaponized by our excess military equipment that are trained in Israel, and that means that we are all at risk. So I always like to remind people that this is not some, you know, little conflict off in some crazy country. This is going to come to bite us. The reason that we have our Fergusons and all the black men that are just assassinated, shoot to kill, is for a reason. And these are the kind of forces that go into making that true in our society.